I teach political science at York, and it's really my great pleasure and honor to have Professor Prabhat Patnaik with us. And I cannot tell you how impeccably timed this is, because the new government in India just took oath this morning. So we have a new prime minister and a new cabinet just as of this morning, which you know is the new wave, and Professor Patnaik is going to tell us all about it. Let me just give you a little bit of an introduction. He's very well known to many of you. Professor Patnaik is a Professor Emeritus at Jawaharlal Nehru University in New Delhi in India. He holds a D.Phil in Economics from the University of Oxford and was awarded an Honorary Doctorate of Science by SOAS in 2012. He has taught at Cambridge, JNU, and is widely recognized in JNU, which is widely recognized as a leading center of critical scholarship. He is currently Professor Emeritus at JNU, having retired in 2010 from the Sukhamoy Chakravarty Chair that he held here. Sukhamoy Chakravarty was another very, very well-known economist in India. And those of you from York who know Professor Himani Banerjee, Sukhamoy Chakravarty is her brother, was her brother. Professor Patnaik was also the vice chairman of the planning board of the southern state of Kerala in India. His main research interests are in the areas of macroeconomics and political economy. He is the author of Time, Inflation and Growth, Economics and Egalitarianism, Whatever Happened to Imperialism and Other Essays, Accumulation and Stability Under Capitalism, The Value of Money, and Re-envisioning Socialism. His edited works include Lenin and Imperialism, An Appraisal of Theories in Contemporary Reality, Macroeconomics, An Excursion in History, and many others. He edits the journal Social Scientist, the journal of the Indian School of the Social Scientists. Social Sciences, and he's the author of hundreds of articles on political economy. And today he's going to speak to us about neoliberalism and politics and the post-election reality in India.
Thank you, Ananya. I'm extremely grateful for this opportunity to come and speak to you. I'm sure a lot of what I'm going to say would be pretty obvious to many of you because very distinguished gathering, and I don't have that many things to say which are different from what you already know. But nonetheless, I must do my bit. So I'll speak for about 45, 50 minutes, and after that we can have a discussion. There are different ways in which one can look at the Indian election results and what's happened, the change that has taken place in the Indian polity. But I would like to look at it in terms of the fact that it is an expression of certain tendencies at the realm, in the domain of politics, which are unleashed by the pursuit of neoliberal economic policies. And that's what I would like to develop. We, of course, live in a universe of globalization. Globalization, above all, means globalization of capital, especially finance capital. Now, obviously, if we are in a world with globalized capital, but governments which really represent nation states, then all the different nation states, governments of different nation states, more or less, have to pursue very similar economic policies, because if you don't, then capital would simply flee your country. Therefore, willy-nilly, as long as you are open to the free movements of capital, willy-nilly, you would have to pursue very similar economic policies, which are broadly what we refer to as the neoliberal economic policies. Therefore, it would follow that if you wish to pursue an alternative set of policies, then somehow you have to get out of the trap of globalization, because only then would you be able to acquire the autonomy, acquire the room for pursuing alternative policies. Now, that being the case, it's obvious that all the different political formations, particularly bourgeois political formations, which are actually vying for electoral office, have more or less similar programs. It's not surprising that in India, in terms of governments, we have had originally a communist government, followed by a United Front government, followed by a BJP-led government, followed by another communist government, and they've all more or less pursued the same economic policies. Not only is it the governments, but even the different political formations have more or less got to have the same sorts of programs, the same sorts of agendas in a very fundamental sense, which is not surprising. And what is more, it's also expressed by the fact that Narendra Modi, the current Prime Minister, his biographer, actually has said that Modi's economic agenda is no different from that of Mr. Chidambaram, who was a finance minister in the earlier government. So basically, the economic agendas tend to be similar. Now, if they tend to be similar, in that case, you have what I call a kind of closure of politics, because then politics ceases to offer alternative options in terms of agendas to people. Everybody is more or less saying exactly the same things, at least in that realm which affects people's material lives directly, that is in the economic realm. So you have a kind of closure of politics. But at the same time, since we are in the midst of a fairly acute economic crisis with inflation close to double digit and going on for years, we are in the midst of an industrial stagnation, even an industrial negative industrial growth that has taken place in the recent period. For instance, the current year, that is 2013-14, industrial growth rate is negative compared to the previous year and so on. So you have industrial stagnation, you have acute inflation, you have acute unemployment. Therefore, we're in the midst of a very serious economic crisis and a potential balance of payments crisis, which is simply kept at bay because of the quantitative easing being pursued by the US Federal Reserve. So in the midst of this crisis, it is natural that different political formations would then try to offer, I mean, how do they differentiate between one another? I mean, if differentiate one from the other as far as the electorate is concerned. Typically, the response consists either in denying the existence of the crisis, which is what the Congress government did. It said, oh, you know, these are very minor things, we'll just overcome them. This is very transient, temporary, and so on. So either you deny the economic crisis, or alternatively, if you assert the economic crisis, then you explain it in terms of bad governance, corruption, indecisive leadership, and so on. Therefore, not anything fundamental, not anything to do with the basic economic policies, but to having to do entirely with the fact that those fellows implementing it were no good. Now, if that is the case, then what you are presenting before the people, and this is not only the political formation, this the entire bourgeois media would talk this way, and so on, all kinds of commentators would talk this way. Therefore, once the reality of the crisis is accepted, then the explanation of the crisis necessarily takes the form of, as it were, finding fault with the manpower that was implementing the neoliberal policies rather than with the policies themselves. Now, if that is the case, then effectively what you are persuading the electorate or persuading the people is that if you have better people doing the same policies, in that case, the country would be doing very well. If you have people who are not corrupt, if you have people who are kind of, you know, good governance and all the rest of it, in effect, you are telling them that if you had ideal characters, if you are selling them a messiah, that if there is a messiah who's above all these flaws, in that case, the neoliberal policies would actually work. And this is obviously the messiah has to be marketed, and the job of marketing is done by corporate capital. As a result, what you have is a real drive on the part of the corporate capital, caught in the midst of a crisis which might delegitimize the neoliberal economic policies, to sell to the people the idea that the policies are because of the fact that you had all kinds of bad people there, but here is a messiah who is actually going to get you out of the crisis and so on. So you have therefore a very substantial increase in the political intervention by corporate capital, and especially in the electoral realm, which is something which I'm going to talk about later. You have therefore one of the conditions of fascism, which Mussolini is alleged to have said, though there's a big doubt about it, fascism consisting of the merger of corporate and state power. But at the same time, it's not enough to actually market a messiah, because that messiah is not simply doesn't have to be a good person and so on, it has to offer something more. And typically what is offered, which is more, is that we are going to have a strong nation, national power, power of the nation and all the rest of it. Now the nation then takes on a very peculiar role, because typically the notion of an Indian nation came into being as a result of the anti-colonial struggle. Now, if you invoke that concept of the nation, then again you have to invoke, as it were, a concept of anti-colonialism or anti-imperialism. Now, that would mean that the neoliberal economic policies, which are necessarily at the behest of international finance capital, backed by US imperialism, is something that you really have to, in some sense, criticize, attack, attempt to withdraw from, and so on. So one of the very important characteristics of oppositional, bourgeois oppositional political activity is that it is not anti-imperialist, and therefore it tends to invoke the concept of a nation which is not the inclusive concept of the nation, but in fact a concept of a nation which is based on a particular subset of the people of the country, typically the majority, and in our case, the Hindutva forces, basing it upon what is sometimes referred to as Hindu nationalism, the Hindu nation. Not only is it therefore based on Hindutva, but at the same time, it has a number of other features. A historian in my university, a very well-known historian, Professor Suvira Jaiswal, has been arguing for quite some time that the essence of Hinduism is the caste system. Once you invoke Hindutva, in that case, in a very fundamental sense, you are really invoking the caste system. You may not say so explicitly, but in a very fundamental sense, you are invoking, you're really appealing to the upper caste. You're invoking, in some sense, the caste system. Therefore, the kind of political movement that builds up in this kind of an economic regime is not only anti-minority, it is also anti the marginalized, and it's also anti-poor, because typically what you have is the argument that any welfare program for the poor consists of handouts. That handouts are in fact imperceptibly in some sense linked to corruption. That this is the way that the government is trying to buy up votes of the poor, and this is something which has to be overcome. So you have an anti-poor, anti-marginalized, anti-minority agenda. Now this agenda is again pushed by the notion, by a discourse on corruption, which we have seen in India in the recent period, and that what that discourse says is that corruption is essentially a moral failing. It's not a structural feature of a neoliberal economy, but it's a moral failing on the part of some people who happen to run this economy. For instance, you would find that all the major big-ticket corruption cases which have surfaced under the previous government are all associated with the privatization of state assets. You know, that neoliberalism essentially means privatizing government assets, And when you privatize government assets, you do so for a song, and as a result, you are really handing over a bonanza to some favored people. In a sense, corruption is really a tax on that bonanza, which is imposed by the politicians concerned. So corruption, on the one hand, in the discourse of corruption which we have seen, detaches it from any structural features of the sort I was talking about, associated with, if you like, what I would call a process of primitive accumulation of capital, because handing over state assets to the private sector for a song is basically part of the process of primitive accumulation of capital. Corruption as a tax on primitive accumulation of capital, by tax I don't mean a legitimate state tax, but a tax imposed by certain particular politicians on this primitive accumulation of capital, which is being facilitated by them, is not seen in that way. It's rather seen as a moral failing. But at the same time, what corruption does, the discourse on corruption does, is that it delegitimizes the political class. That politicians are bad, they're all a corrupt lot. And what is more, they're a corrupt lot with their moral failings. It's interesting that the entire corruption discourse in India never blamed the corporate sector that actually gained out of this corruption, but it succeeded in delegitimizing the political class. Now then, what you have is, of course, saying that the few schemes which are possible within a neoliberal regime, because in a neoliberal regime you cannot really have an implementation of schemes based on universal recognition of universal right to employment or to food and so on, but they necessarily have to be targeted schemes. Targeted schemes can pass, they don't offend international capital too much, and as a result most of these transfer schemes to the poor are highly targeted, fairly narrowly aimed schemes, and it's quite possible therefore to invoke an argument that actually says that these are handouts, that these handouts are really part of this whole corrupt regime, that you know, that this corrupt regime is trying to buy up the poor, buy up the votes of the poor by giving them these handouts. So you have the building up of an anti-poor, an anti-minority, and of course an anti-marginalized agenda. Now this is something which, of course, that this is a phenomenon which we have seen happening in India in the course of these elections. Estimates vary, but one of the estimates suggests that the amount of money which was spent by Narendra Modi simply on his public relations was 5,000 crores of rupees, which is 50 billion rupees, which would be just less than $1 billion, just less than $1 billion, about $0.8 billion. And I'm told that's roughly the amount that Barack Obama had spent on his kind of, you know, publicity campaigns. So an enormous amount of money was spent, and obviously it's corporate funded. At the same time, there was a very clear appeal of a communal fascist character against the Muslims. This was done repeatedly. This was done by Modi himself. This was done by his right-hand man, Amit Shah, who actually asked various people to vote against the kind of, you know, I mean, in order to take revenge on the Muslims. And Modi himself talked about throwing the Bangladeshi infiltrators out, and not all Bangladeshi infiltrators, but Bangladeshi Muslim infiltrators, because the Hindu infiltrators apparently enjoyed a different standing altogether. So very clearly there was, and of course somebody else, Giriraj Singh, who was a big kind of BJP leader, said anybody who criticizes Modi should migrate to Pakistan, and so on. So you had a very clear communal appeal. But at the same time, not only was there a clear communal appeal, but also there was an appeal as far as the so-called handouts are concerned, that we are going to stop the handouts. Now, I think, as you know, there has been, for quite some time now, a lot of opposition within the middle class, urban youths, to, for instance, reservation in jobs for the poor, for the marginalized segments. And obviously, therefore, any such appeal, or any such anti-poor, anti-marginalized agenda is something that really appeals very much to a substantial segment of the urban middle class. You also find, for instance, that the Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme, which was one of the schemes introduced by the previous government, again, a very targeted scheme. You had to do, you know, it offers manual labor to, for a maximum of 100 days to anybody who actually comes and asks for it. It has had a fairly limited scope, but on the other hand, a certain amount of impact. And this is something which has been resented, for instance, in rural areas by segments of the peasantry which belong to the upper caste or to the intermediate castes. So all these agendas, whether it's anti-marginalized, anti-poor, anti-Muslim and so on, is something that actually has a certain appeal to the intermediate caste stroke classes. So what you have really is the marketing of a messiah who presides over the building up of a kind of social block, which consists not only, of course, of the corporate elite, but the corporate elite backed by not only the upper castes and classes generally, but also segments of the intermediate castes and classes. And Modi, for instance, himself went around saying that I belong to a backward caste, which means an intermediate caste. There are lots of doubts about whether he does belong, but on the other hand, this was a very important point of his marketing. And obviously, in a situation where, because of the crisis, the middle class, which has done quite well out of the neoliberal economic policies in the past, you find, I mean, for instance, the urban middle class has certainly done rather well out of the neoliberal economic policies. Certainly segments of it have done very well out of this. Now that you find that neoliberalism has run into a crisis, they would not like an abandonment of neoliberalism. They would like to buy the argument that the reason for the crisis is because neoliberalism was not pursued with a toughness, with a muscularity with which it should have been pursued, but rather it was pursued diluted by all kinds of handouts and of course, you know, kind of accompanied by massive corruption, bad governance, indecisive government, and all the rest of it. So you have the building up of a very powerful ideological brew that is, on the one hand, and xenophobic. Who is this Italian lady who comes and basically presides over the destiny of our country? It's xenophobic, it's anti-Dalit, it's anti-poor, it's anti-Muslim, and of course it is something which actually appeals in a sense to fairly, you know, to fairly large segments of the intermediate classes and strata. You know, many of you may know Kaleski's well-known piece about the intermediate regime and the role of the middle class in societies, in third world societies. And I think if, no matter, even if one may be critical of Kaleski's characterization of the third world state, the fact remains that the middle class plays a very important role. And what you do have very clearly is the middle class backing neoliberalism, opposed to anybody who is opposed to neoliberalism, but on the other hand, finding fault with features like transfers to the poor, etc. Additional to this, and of course all this is happening against a backdrop in which there is a substantial weakening of the left. I think the weakening of the left is not at all surprising in a sense. No matter what the particular mistakes or strategic errors or tactical errors made by the Indian left, all over the world you have a weakening of the left, which arises obviously because, again, if you have a globalized capital, then the trade union movements tend to get weakened, because obviously if you have strong trade unions, capital leaves and goes to some other country. The trade unions become weak. You have a massive process of primitive accumulation of capital taking place through the dispossession of the peasantry from land. You have a substantial exposure of the peasantry to the world market price fluctuations. You have a withdrawal of the support of the state from the peasantry. I mean, maybe I should say a word about it. You see, the Indian anti-colonial struggle had taken off in a very big way in the 1930s. In the 1930s, it really kind of became a fairly significant movement. And one of the reasons it became a fairly significant movement was the Great Depression. In the Depression, the peasantry was hit very badly. And of course, the anti-colonial struggle promised to the peasantry a number of things, one of them being that you are never again going to face a crisis of this kind, because the state that would be formed if we get rid of colonialism would actually support you and defend you. As a matter of fact, the post-independence Indian state did, the dirigist regime, did in fact come and support and protect the peasantry in many, many different ways. Obviously, the benefits of that were unevenly distributed. The rich peasants got most of it and the poor peasants did not. But the fact of the matter is that you had protection from world market price fluctuations. You had an assured price that was guaranteed for 22 different crops with public procurement of these crops at these assured procurement prices. You had subsidies as far as inputs were concerned. You had subsidized credit, which happened after bank nationalization in India in 1969. You had substantial increase in public investment in research and development and the development of high-yielding varieties of seeds, which no matter what you may say about the ecological damage it may have done, basically is something that did increase the incomes of sections of the peasantry. And you also had an increase in government investment in agriculture, which basically meant the kind of stagnation in agriculture that had taken place in the last 50 years of colonial rule was reversed, and you had really an increase in agricultural output, food grains output, and of course the peasantry in many ways benefited out of it. Benefits were unevenly divided, but the fact is that the well-to-do peasantry did well. But now what you have in a neoliberalism is a reversal of all these. Extension services, public extension services have collapsed. As far as subsidies are concerned, they are being withdrawn. As far as nationalized banks are concerned, recently, of course, they have been asked to give loans and so on, but effectively they don't, so that the peasantry is once more forced to go to moneylenders. So you have a situation where agriculture's profitability has gone down, and not surprisingly, agricultural output in per capita terms has stagnated. It has declined, come up a little bit on the whole since the beginning of the of neoliberal policies in the early 1990s. It has tended to stagnate. So the point is that you have, therefore, in the midst of this kind of a situation where the peasantry is being dispossessed of its land in the name of development and so on, and Modi's Gujarat is a leading example of this, and the peasantry's flow incomes have also come down very sharply. Certainly, there is scope, therefore, for actually, generating a certain amount of, the so-called middle strata that Kaleski was talking about, which included the rich peasants. It's capable. I mean, this new kind of thing is capable of generating a consciousness in this stratum that fundamentally the problem arises because the state is giving money to the poor but is not giving you enough money. I am going to give you more money. That, you know, so obviously it's possible to pit one segment of the population against the poor, and this is something which has actually happened. And the capacity of the left to intervene in this goes down because the peasant support for the left is something which tends to weaken in the light of this, because many of the peasants, in fact, are migrating for non-existent jobs in the cities. Very difficult to organize unorganized workers, part-time workers, casual workers, and so on. And of course, the strong formal trade union movement is again getting significantly weakened. You have, as you know, enormous casualization of work, and it's very difficult to organize casual workers. Outside Delhi is the Maruti plant of automobiles. And many trade unions have told me personally that in the old days we would go and hold meetings outside, we would distribute leaflets and so on. Now, if a casual worker, and the workforce has been largely casualized, if a casual worker is seen talking to us, just loses his job. Or is seen having any of our pamphlets, leaflets, just loses his job. So it becomes very difficult for the left in a situation like this, when the basic classes on which it relies, like agricultural laborers, urban workers, peasants and so on, are really facing extraordinary difficulty. It becomes very difficult for the left to organize them. There is a view that actually periods of crisis are easy for the left to organize the basic classes, but that's not necessarily true. Maybe in certain circumstances, yes, but not now. So in the context of all this, you actually have the creation of the conditions in which, I mean, they're conducive to the emergence of a kind of, what I would call, kind of communal fascism, a kind of fascism, because the two basic characteristics, on the one hand, the merger of corporate and state power, on the on the other hand, also dividing the people and finding the external enemy in the midst of the people, which is typically, of course, the minorities. Both of these are there. It need not be pressed, I mean, in the sense that you know, I mean, some people may say, no, wait and see, we cannot call them fascists. But whatever it is, the fundamental point is that the emergence of scope for a right-wing turn in politics, which is, as it were, characterized by strong element of fascism, is very much there in these kinds of conditions. Many people have raised the question, is this an event? 5 years down the line, it is obvious that the kind of hope and promise which has been generated by the political forces is something which is going to be belied. And if that is the case, then people are going to turn away from them. So is it only an event, or is it something which actually represents, in some sense, a more permanent shift, a more basic shift? Now, I would say that, take, you know, that this character of this movement being anti-poor, anti-marginalized, and not only communal, I mean, it's not only anti-Muslim, it's also anti-poor, anti-marginalized, and so on, really has more fundamental implications, which in my view are the following. That you see, if you look at the last 100 years of Indian history, then you find that, you know, we have been experiencing a kind of long, silent social revolution. I mean, I know that, you know, that many people would cavil at the use of the term social revolution, but I think I would use it. You look at a state like Kerala. 100 years ago in Kerala, you not only had untouchability, but you actually had unseeability, that an upper caste person would get polluted simply by seeing somebody who belonged to the Dalit castes. And therefore they used to go around with bells around their necks, which would announce that they are coming, in which case, if that sound was there, then somebody, then the charioteer or whatever, the person who was driving the upper caste man, would shout out, and the Dalit would hide until this man's vehicle had passed. So that was the kind of world that we lived in. Compared to that, even the acceptance of one person, one vote is something which really represents a very significant change. Now, I would really call it, at any rate, of course, the Dalits' economic position is something which continues to be fairly precarious, but nonetheless, at least there is a certain commitment to reservations, there is a certain commitment to an egalitarian order which is enshrined in the constitution, and to the extent governments renege on it, you can hold the governments responsible that you're reneging on your constitutional duties and so on. But now what you are having is a kind of counter-revolution to that revolution. If you have Hindutva, in that case, fundamentally, as I said, Hindutva goes against the fundamental egalitarian ethos of the Indian constitution, because there is no Hindutva without the caste system. to the extent that is anti-poor, then that again goes against the fundamentally egalitarian ethos, which at least till now everybody paid lip service to, and so on. So in a certain sense, it legitimizes an ideology of counter-revolution to the long revolution that India has experienced. And to that extent, it does represent, in my view, a significant shift. Not that it cannot be reversed, but on the other hand, it does represent not just a government coming to power, but a government that is coming to power, which is also at the same time going to change the certain kind of, at least the ideological ethos and so on in the country. Now, for instance, at this moment, there is a fairly large amount of noise which is made that this handout should be stopped. In fact, there is a remarkable theory which is being advanced that the crisis of the Indian economy is because of the handouts, because of these pro-poor measures. Now, which is complete nonsense, even though this is every day it is mentioned in the media and so on. Why do I say it's complete nonsense? Let's just look at the theory. Let's just look at it theoretically. To say that inflation is because the government actually is spending so much on the MGNREGS, that is this Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme, would theoretically make sense if inflation was an excess demand inflation. You know, I mean, economists draw this distinction between an excess demand inflation and, let's say, cost push inflation. You see, if it's because of the fact that compared to the available supplies, there is excessive demand, that's because too much purchasing power has been put into the hands of the people. And if there is an inflation because of that, then you can say it's an excess demand inflation. And at least there is some theoretical basis at all for suspecting that, okay, maybe these big expenditures by the government, it's not very big by the way, but maybe these expenditures by the government are responsible. But in India today, you just look at food grains, for instance. Last year, in 2012, 82 million tons of food grain stocks were held by the government. In the last 2 years, the government has exported, because rats were eating away the food grains, and exported 40 million tons of food grains. Why doesn't the government distribute food grains? Because if you distribute food grains, you have procured these food grains, let us say, at 20 rupees a kilo. If you distribute these food grains to the public distribution system, if you distribute it in the open market, speculators will buy it up, makes no impact. But if you distribute it through the public distribution system, then your subsidies go up, because then you distribute it at 2 rupees a kilo, and therefore 18 rupees a kilo is the amount that the budget has to bear. And therefore they argue, if the subsidies go up, fiscal deficit goes up. If fiscal deficit goes up, finance capital gets upset, and consequently the government holds on to stocks without distributing them. Now look at the absurdity of this argument. When you have given 20 rupees to the peasants, you have already put purchasing power into the economy. If you sell food, whether it is for 2 rupees or 1 rupee or half a rupee, you're actually withdrawing purchasing power from the economy. As a result, the sale of food grains to the PDS is a disinflationary measure rather than an inflationary measure. But the reason they don't do it is because of the neoliberal regime, because they don't want to offend finance capital. If you did it, then Moody's would downgrade your ratings, and then that creates problems within this kind of a regime. So it's not an excess demand inflation when it comes to fundamentally food grains. When you talk about the industrial sector, I mentioned that the industrial sector has an absolute stagnation for 2 years now. And in fact, in the current year, that means the year that has just ended, 2013-14, April, March is the kind of financial year. During that, you have actually had a drop in industrial output compared to the previous year. Now, obviously, the fundamental reason for the drop in industrial output is absence of demand. Therefore, it is not as if there is too much demand in the economy, but there is too little demand in the economy. So inflation come recession has nothing to do with putting purchasing power in the hands of the poor through the Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme, But on the other hand, that is something which is currently the buzzword, and that and lots of economists, you'd always find economists to back up such absurd arguments. Lots of economists are saying so, and one of the first things the government is going to do is at least to roll it back, not fully, they won't dare to, but to roll it back, to confine it to some districts and so on, no longer a universal scheme, etc. So we now, therefore, have the beginnings of, as I said, a kind of counter-revolution in which transfers to the poor are considered bad economics, in which reservation, as far as the, affirmative action in the form of reservation is something which is looked down upon. In any case, when you have privatization of public sector activities, there is no reservation in the private sector. So that is effectively de-reserving various kind of activities, and of course you would continue to have a situation where the Muslim minority would feel more and more ghettoized. So there is a withdrawal, as it were, from the idea of an inclusive nation on the basis of which the anti-colonial struggle was actually fought. But on the other hand, I do believe that it's possible to intervene, you know, in other words, the counter-revolution is not inevitable. I mean, you know, so it's possible to intervene. But I think one of the ways in which intervention can be done is that if you have selected targeted benefits of the kind that rural employment guarantee and so on are, or even the Right to Food Act, which was passed by Parliament very recently, the moment you have targeted programs, it becomes possible to pit one segment of the population against the other. But if you want to define an inclusive concept of citizenship, where every citizen is entitled to a set of rights which include right to employment, right to food, and so on, in that case, it becomes possible to in fact have an alternative agenda, though this alternative agenda would mean that neoliberal regime is something we have to get out of. But the fact remains that I think it's possible to have an alternative agenda, not of the kind that the UPA government had, which was basically giving selected benefits to some segments of the population within a broadly neoliberal regime, but actually an alternative agenda, which means getting out of the neoliberal regime, but fundamentally assuring every citizen a set of basic rights to food, employment, healthcare, education up to a certain level, quality education up to a certain level, and so on. In that case, I think we should be able to project an alternative at a time when, in any case, the Modi economic agenda would be coming a cropper anyway. Fundamentally, the way I see it, just to summarize and end, is that I began by talking about a closure of politics. I think the entry of this right-wing fascist, semi-fascist politics is one which provides a kind of phony way out of that closure. People want a way out of that closure of politics. This provides a phony way out of that closure. But on the other hand, the fact that it does so is something which creates the danger that when the phoniness becomes clear, then they may actually go further down the road and kind of further proceed on the lines of the counter-revolution in order to, you know, enlist support from intermediate strata on the basis of communalism and so on. The alternative, therefore, to get out of this closure is to have an alternative agenda that actually tries to invoke the concept of an inclusive citizenship and for that, therefore, invoke a set of universal rights that might actually mobilize the people away from this kind of divisive politics. I think I could stop there. Thank you very much.